Good day, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Brereo Skarensky, and welcome to the review of Anata no Yonkihi Kyodotan, Nipponichi's latest game. The title translates to Your Four Knight Princesses Training Story, and it's available on the Vita, PS4, and Switch. Footage in this review is from Nintendo's Hybrid, and as I write this, there are no plans to bring the title outside Japan. As the title implies, the stars of this game are four princesses that you, as a renowned instructor knight, must train throughout various hardships. Anna Kyon, I'm shortening the title like that, is divided into two main parts. During the first part, you'll play a short campaign with all four princesses, and then choose one of them to follow her through a longer campaign that will also close that princess's story arc. Everyone has different endings based on the trust between her and your avatar, with replayability somewhat further enhanced by slightly different dialogues based on your avatar's personality. Anna Kyon isn't particularly long, around 12 hours from start to finish. The second campaign is about 4 hours long if you don't grind battles too much, and if you plan your save games correctly, you won't have to replay the first 4 introductory campaigns. The first thing to do in a campaign is to set up teams you'll then dispatch from the princess castle. Two of these teams belong to you and the princess, the others must be recruited from various mercenaries. All units in Anna Kyon belong to a different class: knight, mage, archer, and winged, arranged in a simple rock-paper-scissors circle. Teams are composed by a leader and 3 troops. The chosen leader will also dictate the kind of troop that will accompany him or her. As the game goes on, different leaders with more powerful troops will become available, as well as more advanced troops for you and the princess. Teams move on an overworld composed by several locations connected by pathways. Movement is in real time, and some missions require to stop enemies from reaching a fixed destination or a moving ally. Teams can wander around the map as long as they have enough APs and health to partake effectively in action segments. Should one of the two get dangerously low, it's possible to immediately send teams back to the castle. Teams will need some time to rest, counted in in-game hours that equate to about 1 minute in the real world. Sending teams back to the castle is the only way to replace lost troops or change a team's composition. While not an incredibly deep system, there are situations where you'll have to manage troop movements carefully or risk a game over, and the only thing I can say about this phase is that some of the later maps are uselessly large. There will be always 2 training spots to bring new teams up to speed, a few treasure chests scattered around, at least a couple of random enemy teams, and mission markers, but it's not enough to really liven up any overworld, often resulting in boringly long segments where you wait for an unit to reach something. You can speed up time, but there is still too much waiting in later maps. When a team touches an enemy token or reaches a mission location, Anna Kyon will switch to an action segment where you'll take direct control of the team's leader. Leaders can attack, dash, use special skills, or give troops basic orders. Troops simply follow the leader around and won't act until ordered so. The basic attack is executed immediately wherever troops are, so you must mind their position and facing, otherwise their attacks could end wasted. Holding down the right shoulder button will set troops free and they will gang up on the nearest enemy, attacking as they see fit and acting as shield for their leader. The right shoulder button also unleashes special moves when combined with face buttons. Dungeons are littered with relics, which are hostile at first, but can be captured by your troops and be used a limited number of times against enemies. You can capture as many relics as you want, but only the last will be active, requiring you to think about the overall picture rather than blindly capturing everything in sight. For example, passive relics like healing points are always active once captured, even if you get another relic, but active relics will stop being usable if you capture a passive relic after. At times, relics are clumped together and it's difficult to precisely point which one you want to capture, or use something you've already under your control, or order your troops to attack, as all these actions share the same button. Action segments are nicely done, though they are repetitive. All overworlds only have a few stage layouts and the game blocks certain areas off to give the impression of a larger pool of available stages. The four unit classes don't really amount to much, and while troops and relics do boost firepower in certain occasions, the burden to complete the stage is always on you as the leader. Some classes are much more effective than others, with archers being the hardest to control and order around due to low attack values and relatively long reload times. Mages, on the other hand, are incredibly strong and their bullets travel through walls. Mages are weak, but it's easy to sit back and punish enemies from afar. Opposition isn't particularly strong, but it's easy to die. Enemies might spawn right next to you and it's not easy to distinguish them from your own units. Bullets are a bit too small and too easy to miss, even on large screens. The interface on the Switch in handheld mode is the same as in docked mode, but isn't particularly bad once you're used to it, but I fear that it might be too small on the Vita if Nipponichi didn't optimize it. Graphic filters around the screen's edges are a bit too heavy, often masking enemies that are already attacking you. There are only a few bosses in Anakion and, well, first, they are strangely quiet as they don't have almost any sound effect associated to them or their attacks, and second, they are way too easy. In one particular occasion, all I had to do was sit on one of the boss's sides and continuously attack with Veronica and her mages to defeat it. No dodges or even moving was necessary as the boss was stationary and all attacks were on the frontal arc. Sure, this is just one encounter, but some random enemies require a lot more interaction to be brought down, and it's always a letdown to see bosses going down so easy. There is no difficulty selection, although the princesses themselves might be. Mono Maria is the hardest to play with due to her accompanying troops, low mobility and low damage. Liliati and Alpana are close-range warriors and have average health and damage, while Veronica can pick enemies at range with ease and her low health doesn't really represent a drawback. The four princesses have very distinct personalities and you'll be able to pick up how their story arcs will go in the introductory campaigns, and personally I've found Veronica and Alpana the most interesting of the bunch. During action stages and certain cutscenes, you'll need to praise, or scold, your princess. This will increase, or decrease, the trust she has in you, and during action stages it will also give various bonuses. This mechanic is perfectly fine during cutscenes, although in a couple of occasions the game asked me to praise or scold with little to no idea why I should interact with the princess. During action stages, this praise-scold mechanic feels rather strange because you are praising yourself for doing good in battles. Praising and scolding is also used to teach ideas that will translate into better stats once both you and the princess are at the castle. At the castle, you can assign to a princess up to 2 ideas that she can develop during action stages, partake in simple minigames, or spend skill points to improve your avatar. This step is actually very important, although very easy to overlook, as you'll always want your avatar and the princess on the front lines as they are the most powerful units. Anakion has a very distinct graphical style. Portraits are particularly wispy while talking and their lines always end up in a peculiar jump that makes easy to advance a cutscene without cutting voices as there is no auto button. The interface looks very busy, but even with all the moving elements, the attention is always on the characters talking and where they are. On the Switch, the overall layout is clear enough for both docked and handheld mode, though some text entries might be a bit too small.
それって何だか愛の告白みたい。キモ!
Music is rather subdued and forgettable, while voices are a perfect fit for the four princesses. Of particular note is the performance of Kengo Kawanashi, who voices every single male character, from your avatar's 5 voice samples to the last of NPCs. It's particularly fun to notice this the first time, and seeing every single character he voiced in the credits is quite impressive. As a whole, Anata no Yonki Hikyo Dotan is not a bad game. It's in fact pretty fun to play, and it has that Nipponichi feeling that makes it rather charming. However, no matter if you take single elements alone or consider them as a single entity, Anakion never goes past being average. The overworld, the action segments, even the story, lack in depth and refinement, and the impression is not that Nipponichi didn't know how to elaborate on the various mechanics, but rather they purposefully left them as they are, unwilling to exploit their full potential. The net result is an enjoyable game that will be forgotten the moment you stop playing it, despite it doing nothing bad or terrible, but on the other hand, nothing particularly good or memorable either. The best way to describe Anata no Yonki Hikyo Dotan is simply average. Nothing more, nothing less. You won't miss anything if you don't play it, you won't regret it if you do so. I'd still look forward for a localization though. I hope you have enjoyed this review, and you'll stick around for more. Briareos Kerensky, over and out.
けどさ、人の話は最後まで聞きなさいって。そういえば最初の頃もそうやって怒られたっけ？